Welcome to the Haus der Kulturen der Welt, to this wonderful program series, Das Bild hinter dem Bild, zur Lage der Kunst in China. I'm very grateful to the Universität der Künste. We are mixing English, German, and you will get a lot of Chinese tonight. I'm grateful to the Universität der Künste for this wonderful cooperation and opportunity. I especially welcome our guests from China, Qiu Zhijie and Davide Quadrio, who will be introduced in a few minutes. 1 week ago, Das Haus der Kulturen der Welt, the HKW, started the Anthropocene project. Man changes not only nature, he makes nature. He changes the surface of the earth to such an extent that it becomes man-made. But who is this man? Who is this Anthropos? Qiu Zhijie's work, Twilight of the Idols, which we presented in 2009 here in the HKW, could have been the opening exhibit of this project. In his work, there was a clock counting the time back from the year 5000 AD, and thereby contextualizing our time into another time frame, going far beyond short-term thinking. In the Anthropocene project, it could have been also 100,000 years, reminding us that we inscribe ourselves into geological time. This way. The Twilight of the Idols was a project about cultural memory, the memory of the symbols of modernity. Chinese modernity, which was partly also Western modernity, brought to China by Mao Zedong. It was a reflection by images and imagination about a concrete building, the Nanjing Bridge, which was at the same time much more a symbol of modernity. The tallest bridge ever built at that time by Chinese, a sign of progress, envisioning the future, a sign for what Chinese culture is capable of doing, of achieving its project of modernity. But it was also the place where more and more people committed suicide. People who did not adapt to the new time, people who lost the race into the new world, people who used the height of the bridge to fall into their death, giving with the last jump from this symbol their lives a meaning. Twilight of the Idols was an exploration of archives and symbols, the attempt to understand the present by going back to the past, reflecting on architecture in order to understand the ideology of our time. It was wonderful to present this work here in the former Congress Hall, itself a building resulting from the dreams and aspirations of building a new society in the 50s and the 60s. A building which collapsed in 1980, a building in the meaning of which we attempt to reinterpret by presenting works such as The Twilight of the Idols and by talking to artists and intellectuals such as Qiu Zhijie and Davide Quadrio. Welcome, both of you. The curators of this evening are Andreas Schmidt and Bignia Verli. Both artists lived and studied in China but belong to different generations. Andreas Schmidt has been working as a visual artist and expert for contemporary Chinese art since 1987. During a three-year study visit at the Chinese Art Academy Hangzhou in the early 80s, he got concerned with the upcoming contemporary and experimental Chinese art. Together with Han van Dijk and Jochen Noth, he curated in 1993 the first big interdisciplinary visual arts concerts, film lectures and discussions program for Chinese contemporary art in Europe, China Avant-Garde, here at the Haus der Kulturen der Welt. Ever since, he intensely and critically attends the development of Chinese contemporary art in articles and lectures. Bignia Verli the independent artist also attended the China Academy of Art in Hangzhou. Due to her excellent Chinese skills, she quickly established a network within the young Chinese artistic community and is intensely involved in the artistic and intercultural exchange with China. Welcome, both of you.
Thank you very much, Bernd Scherer, for your kind words. Welcome from Binya and me as a project team of this second event of Hidden Images on the Situation of Art in China. Today, Qiu Zhijie, the artist and curator of the Shanghai Biennale, will give a talk about moments and memory. Afterwards, David Quadrio from Arthub Asia will have a discussion with Qiu about the Shanghai Biennale. As a project team, Binya and me would like to say just a few words about the whole program. It's a one-year series of panel discussions, talks, and workshops. And with this series of events instigated by the UDK Berlin, we want to show the many different aspects of the colorful and turbulent art scene to widen the knowledge and understanding of what's going on in China. We invited and will invite international experts, all protagonists of Chinese contemporary art and involved in the latest rapid developments in China's most recent art history, to get into discussion and exchange and in an exchange with experts from here. We want to gain views from both inside and outside, gradually revealing an unaccustomed picture that can assume many forms, the pictures behind the picture, the hidden images. I would like to give a short introduction to Qiu Zhijie. Qiu Zhijie was born in Zhangzhou, Fujian province in 1969. He studied printmaking at the National Academy of Fine Art Hangzhou and graduated in 1992. He is known as one of the most active and most radical artists and thinkers of the Chinese art scene today. He's working as a curator, art critic, writer, investigator, researcher, and teacher, and has had and still has a great influence on the development of Chinese art during the last two decades. In 1996, he organized the first video exhibition with video artists of all over China. 1999, he curated the performance event Post-Sense Sensibility in Beijing, which caused very controversial debates. 2001, he got director of the art magazine Next Wave. And 2002, he initiated the Long March project with Lu Jie. In 2003, he got professorship at the Hangzhou, at the National Academy in Hangzhou. His photo works, the light calligraphy, and the copying and rewriting of the classic calligraphy Lanting Xu, Orchid Pavilion, are already part of the Chinese art history. Today he will talk about monuments and memory, and I wish you a wonderful evening. I just would like to recommend the next lecture talk, which will take place on January 30th at the UDK, about the 85 movement and the modern consciousness, the Chinese avant-garde in the 80s with Martina Köppel-Young and myself. Now, Binya will talk a little bit.
Hello to everybody. I just wanted to add some words about Davide Quadrio from Italy, living in China since many years, since 20 years. And he was studying Chinese and Chinese Eastern art history in Venice, and then moved in the early 90s to China, where he is really engaged in mainly in the Shanghai art scene, and but in whole Asia now. In 1999, he founded the Viz Art Art Center, the first non-profit space and art lab in China, and which he managed for 10 years. And in 2007, he founded Arthub Asia together with Qiu Zhijie and also and Defneayas, a network for artistic production to promote artistic production in Asia. And well, there are many other things to say, but he's also co-curator of the City Pavilion project in the Shanghai Art Biennale. So they will, both of them will talk about it later. And now first to Qiu Zhijie's presentation. Yesterday he presented us his, in Urika, he presented us his educational work in the Total Art Studio in China Academy of Art. And who was there yesterday from that presentation, we know that the social research is very important for his artistic work. And tonight now you will see how this research project includes and transforms such profound material of social and historical research in his own art creation, and to the topic monuments and memories. So, yes, we give the word to you. And
we wish you a wonderful evening. Bye-bye. Thank you. It's your turn.
Thank you for your introduction. I'm sorry, I'm going to speak in Chinese. 好，那都不习惯讲中文。
I'm not so used to speaking Chinese, actually. So today, I'm going to talk about some of my work going back to 3 years ago when I exhibited Idol of the Twilight. So you can actually see some of the books that I used in the room next to this hall. Because I was coming to Berlin to exhibit, so naturally I wanted to incorporate some of the elements from Berlin in my work. When I first visited Berlin, and the visit actually was coordinated by Andreas, and I visited the Kunst Center in Berlin and many of the other spaces, and I remember there was a graveyard in Berlin. I happened to walk by it, and I saw several tombstones, including that of Heidegger. And also, of course, the tomb of other German philosophers, some well-known, some less well-known. Of course, I think it's probably difficult for the less well-known philosophers to be placed next to the very famous ones. And I noticed the historical importance of these tombstones. So if we look at monuments, actually monuments can be considered like a clock. So if we look at the monuments functioning as a sundial, we know that many cultures used sticks to tell time. So by noon, we could see the lack of a shadow, and during sunset, the shadows would then, of course, mark what time of day. So we see the circular movements of the sundial on the floor. So in this respect, monuments, it is also an instrument by which shadows are created. So while I was in Berlin, I took many photos of monuments and the shadows that were projected on the ground. And I took these images and made them cut them out with black cloth and hung them on the glass. So you could see that in the afternoon, new shadows are created by the light. I selected about 14 or 15 most famous monuments from Berlin, including Bismarck, Friedrich II, Max and Wilhelm von Humboldt, Marx, etc. So I continuously recorded the play of the shadows on the floor because the shadows, of course, change on a daily basis, on an hourly basis, if you will. So I would actually write down on the floor the different time of day and record the different shadows. And on the other side of the wall, I placed glass lenses in the shapes of black crows, which reflect the many birds that hang around the tombstones and the monuments. And the direction or the angle at which I place the mirrors, the glass lenses, will then, of course, reflect the light differently. In the middle of the exhibition hall, there are nine separate monuments. And we can see the heroes of these monuments are walking on a tightrope, on the cables, hanging quite high from the ceiling. The title of this exhibition is taken from a German song. On the other end of this exhibition hall, I placed different books that I purchased from used bookstores or from street vendors in Berlin, including not only books, but also music sheets. And I took a lot of them back with me to Beijing, actually, to keep for my own collection, but most of it I used for the installation. Some of the books I dyed in black, and I put it on the floor in the shape of a bridge. And as the wind or blows, or rather the fan blows, you can see the pages of the book blows just like water next to a bridge. So the nine monuments correspond to the nine parts of the Nanjing Bridge, and the books or the pages are in black to correspond to the water. And another exhibition here is a diploma. This diploma, as you can see, has the picture of the Nanjing Bridge. And on the back, I've used many different elements such as fruit, music sheets, different words are reflected, and my assistant works behind the scene, the diploma. So here you can see from the diploma, there's the star, and then on the other side you see it's actually some laundry materials. And this is a picture from the actual performance. Perhaps some of you here tonight actually have seen the performance. And here are the very three famous flagpoles. At the Nanjing Bridge, there are also some rusty flagpoles. The name of this installation is that we finally beat these bastards. This comes from a quotation from Edmund Hillary, who you might know was the first British, or rather first man from New Zealand who scaled Mount Everest. When he finally climbed Mount Everest, he said, "We finally beat these bastards." Of course, Edmund Hillary was not only a mountain climber, he also bred bees. So next to the flagpoles of the Nanjing Bridge, I put two different beehives, and the bees are flying about, so that this indicates that a metal cage cannot lock the bees. So the bees from Eastern Germany can still fly freely to Western Germany. I also used computer print on photo, like as if it's a photo booth. So you can see that German friends can take pictures next to figures from the 1970s posed next to the Nanjing Bridge. Every Chinese person has always dreamt of taking a picture next to the Nanjing Bridge, but most people cannot make that trip, so they go to a photo studio where the background of the Nanjing Bridge is printed on a cloth. This is something else that I put at the exhibition, which is a countdown clock. It's very small, but it's very important. I asked for the help from some IT experts, and I asked them to help me build a countdown clock counting down to 5000 AD. So technically speaking, it was quite difficult to build this countdown clock. So from now, how many days, how many hours, how many minutes do we need to count down until 5,000? At that point, there were still, I think, over 2,019 days and so-so hours and minutes and seconds. So we hope that we have enough batteries for the countdown clock to run actually until 5,000. At the same time, I also use coal, pieces of coal, to create relief, basically to teach children how to use coal to make relief. And there's a clear connection with monuments. So at the same time, when they're making the relief, they can also use the coins that they have on their bodies to print on the final relief picture. Now, going back to the Nanjing Bridge, started construction in the 1950s. It isn't actually the first bridge on the Yangtze River. The first bridge on the Yangtze River actually was in Wuhan, but it was built under the Soviet period. So actually, most Chinese people like to talk about the Nanjing Bridge as the most important bridge on the Yangtze River. And this is the first bridge that used purely Chinese technology, million tons of concrete. And this means that people had to starve and conserve in order to contribute to the purchase of the million tons of concrete to build the bridge. So it goes without saying that the bridge was painstakingly built, took over 10 years. And upon completion, Mao Zedong wrote the following words to commemorate this bridge, which is, "We accomplished this through independence and autonomy." The bridge was inaugurated the day before Mao Zedong's birthday. And on this day, we saw on the People's Daily, it made headline news. Of course, since the bridge was constructed during the Cultural Revolution, it is a clear symbol for heroism and for socialism. There are over 200 reliefs on the bridge that documents the history of contemporary China. And the reliefs were completed by some of the older artists from China. Of course, the Nanjing Bridge is a contemporary monument. It is a super monument, if you will, of modern China. It represents the new China. It is a very important monument in modern Chinese history. In the textbooks, in notebooks, in towels, in all sorts of products, you will see the Nanjing Bridge appear. As a child, when I was in school, whenever I received a diploma of merit, the picture of Nanjing Bridge would be printed on the diploma. Now, looking at the Nanjing Bridge from another angle, sadly, it is also a very popular destination for suicides. Since its inauguration, over 1,200 people have attempted to kill themselves, or perhaps even more than that, because official figures tend not to be very accurate. If we say someone on a particular day attempted to jump off the bridge, usually the names are not published, so it's very difficult for us to get an accurate number of, and if you can see from the picture, the pool of blood is very sadly someone we tried to rescue, but he managed to kill himself. I've been very active in trying to prevent suicides on the Nanjing Bridge. I've talked to their families. Many families of suicide victims, they go to the bridge on the Chinese Memorial Day to pay their respects. And a lot of people that we managed to rescue to prevent from them from killing themselves have become volunteers to help our cause to prevent additional suicide. And we asked them to share with us their experiences, why they wanted to kill themselves. And most of the interviews actually were conducted anonymously. As you can see from the left-hand side, I only show the back of their heads because I don't want to reveal who they are. So this was the foundation from which I began the suicidology of the Nanjing Bridge project. And the four parts of this project are separated between first think tank, archives, crystalloid, and clinic. What do I mean by crystalloid? Of course, as an artist, when you're working on this project, I am actually processing the different experiences that I've had in the process. So I myself experience a transformation, or rather, my experiences are crystallized into elements that are as a result of the work that I've done in the project.
These are these various things that I've collected. Lots of these are the pictures from the Nanjing Bridge, including those documentation documents that I've collected. Some of these are for decorating purposes in Beijing's museum. We also create the effect that mimicking the waves on the Yangtze River. The thinking tank is a kind of a painting, the purpose of which is that I can sell the paintings to use the money to support those organizations that are stopping people from suicide, from killing themselves. But more importantly, I think there is a more meaningful purpose, because when we save them, we need to talk to them, we listen to their sad stories, very, very sad indeed. And these sad stories are really depressing. When you listen to these stories every day, you become a negative kind of waste, a being, and affecting you so badly, even to the possibility that you want to kill yourself too. So we tried to teach them, to talk to them between the relationships of various things, between why you want to kill yourselves and what kind of significance of Nanjing as a city itself, because this city is had a very sad history. Lots of massacres took place in Nanjing, either by Chinese in the historic sense or by Japanese invaders in more modern time. So we try to use these stories to persuade them to not to kill themselves. Let's give you some examples. On the left, some of the
graffitis written by the person who wanted to commit suicide. They say, I lost my love, I want to kill myself. Then I erased all these graffitis, and I cut my fingers using the blood to write on the right, which says, where is the capital of Madagascar? The Nanjing Bridge project, we have four exhibitions taking place. The first one is called Zhuangzi as a scene. Zhuangzi is a philosophy, historical philosophy. The second one is Cool as a theme. The heading was from a famous writer in China called Lu Xun, who wrote an article talking about the sacrifice of a coal, and also reflecting the fact that many people were sacrificed in China. We use the dust of the coal to produce the sculpture and to reproduce the black cow, the black crow, the bird. I will talk more about this later on. This installation is a kind of ink-making machine. It is also representing the Nanjing Bridge. There is a small hole. The ink-making machine using the material representing the construction of the bridge. This is diploma number one. We show you diploma number four previously, but this particular diploma, we use the metal to make the metal into those weapons, like knives. And here you see the barriers of the Nanjing Bridge. The materials are coal or dust of the coal, and you can see these handprints on the barrier. Here is diploma number three. We dismantled all these pictures in the diploma itself. It's a certificate, and we put it on the floor because you can see these are vehicles transporting coal, and you can see this is official seal or stamp, and there are some Chinese characters as well. Also the weed and the gears, industrial gears, and three or six flags. We put them on the floor. Next, I'm talking about the Chinese monument. In Nanjing, you see this monument called Yangshan Monument. On the left is my painting, and it's part of my think tank. The first emperor of Ming Dynasty, Zhu Yuanzhang, wanted to produce the largest monument in Nanjing. There are three parts, the bottom, and the upper part, and the top. When he produced this, he didn't manage to transport the monument to Nanjing, so he left it to where it was, and he didn't succeed to transport it into Nanjing. There is another famous place in Nanjing, which is called Square City. On the left again is my painting called The City of Failure. The turtles on the monument was moved by myself purposefully. to elsewhere. Those rescue people told me when those people killing themselves jumping over to the bridge, they didn't immediately kill themselves, but rather they jump about on the top, on the surface of the water. So this representing that, this square city, of course, was produced by one of the Ming dynasty's emperors. It's a huge project, very big indeed. It's like a famous artist used to say, you have a city underground, which you don't see. This installation will probably be bought by the city of Nanjing, and to put it in one of those museums in Nanjing. Here we see another monument from Tang Dynasty, Wu Zetian, the only female emperor in China. Before he died, he asked people to build this monument without any Chinese characters on it, meaning whether I made contributions, it's left to the other people to judge. From these pictures, we can see the Western monuments and Chinese monuments are different. In the West, when the emperor was victorious, they will build a huge monument with these heroes, on top. But in China, it's different. Chinese monuments tend to have Chinese characters or stories written on it, whether it is Ming Dynasty, Qing Dynasty, or the modern China, Chiang Kai-shek. Here, even in contemporary China, President Jiang Zemin was also writing his calligraphy on one of the monuments. In China, the top universities, the name of the top universities must be given by the calligraphy of Chairman Mao Zedong, otherwise it's not going to be first-class university. So the calligraphy and the Chinese handwriting is one of the core elements in the monuments. So the Chinese monument may have a different meaning with the Western monument. In China, it is mainly written Chinese characters or stories behind it. The monument itself can be very high, very tall, and producing shadows, very long shadows. And the Chinese monuments also have lots of words in it. It's like a book. You need to open the book to read it, and then it's not very clear. You have to make efforts to rub it. So what we call it rubbing of the document, rubbing of the monument in order to read the stories written on it. But in Europe, again, it's different. You have different materials, very good materials, in order to control the past as well as control the future. So people have the strong urge of power, and try to make the power everlasting. So they realize that no matter how strong you are going to die anyway. So for the Tang Dynasty's emperor, the female emperor Wu Zetian, She doesn't want to put any characters on her monument, which is quite interesting, because this will become useful for the nostalgia in the Chinese monument. We call it nostalgia because the modern man are actively trying to find the meaning and the story behind the those historical monuments. They started from today, from the individuals themselves, in order to interact with the history, with the story behind the monuments. So that the history can be meaningful, can be integrated into modern life. So this is a tradition in China, nostalgia. In fact, this element of nostalgia is one of the most important themes of the Chinese literature. You have a lot of poems, pictures, lots of famous poetic lines are connected with Nanjing, the city of Nanjing. Because two cities, of course, earlier you have poems describing Xi'an, but after Song Dynasty, most of these poems, nostalgia poems, describing Nanjing. I don't know whether I'm good at telling stories. Scholars want to touch these fencings in order to trace back to the history. In Nanjing, you have a lot of such scenes. One of the important scenes is the Nanjing Bridge. Here it is Mount Tai. We collected lots of broken stones to put these stones onto the wall to create another monument. These monuments are cross-timing. They continuously becoming increasingly larger. Everybody can contribute. It's not completed. It's always enlarging. In China, you have many such places: Taishan, West Lake in Hangzhou, etc.
So the Chinese monuments, if you will, are endless. They're constantly evolving. Unlike the Western or the European monuments, they tend to glorify the past. But Chinese monuments are more organic, if you will. They're constantly evolving. This is from my home village, Fushan. And you can see some of the monuments. As a child, I learned how to do rubbings from these stones. And this is the cave from Hangzhou. This type of monument is actually a more open for spectators. It's almost like a lounge or a living room where passerbys can sit down and admire and look up close. As a child growing up in this environment, I've always been very fascinated by monuments. This picture comes from 1994 during the Memorial Day or All Saints Day in China. I actually blocked some of the names, and the relatives, when they come to visit the tombs, they have to actually peel off the papers that I stuck on the tombstones by hand. So in this respect, we test the memories of the families. And in Europe, you don't have that problem because the monuments always represent a person rather than words. And here is the work that I did on the grinding of the stones. I work. I actually found a tombstone from New York that belonged to a little girl who died about 100 years ago. And the Chinese counterpart, I used a stone from 1500 years ago, and I grinded the two stones, the two tombstones together. And then I rubbed on the grinding stones. I remember an old American lady was very angry at me. She said, you know, you're actually destroying cultural heritage. But I told her, well, the stone actually is being used in China to build pig pens. I mean, farmers have no respect for stones that are 1,500 years old. In 2006, I embarked on a project of memory archaeology. So since China began printing newspapers, we see each block represents the title or the headline of each newspaper and represent the different evolved ideas such as democracy, modernity, people. So I include the calligraphy from Mao Zedong, but also of Deng Xiaoping, and also the southern newspaper calligraphy. So from this memory archaeology, we see the evolution of calligraphy of memory in China. So that was a shot from my workshop. And here, basically, I took the revolutionary jargons and wrote them in different fonts or different calligraphic styles. So each block represents a revolutionary jargon with regard to freedom, to equality, egalitarianism. How can we equally contribute property based on the fundamental concepts of socialism, of communism? Of course, after hundreds of years, we'll see that the property eventually ends up the property of the rich. So again, 300 years later, we're going to have a start of a new revolution where people are yelling for the equal distribution of land. So in other words, actually, these revolutionary jargons are repetitive. So centuries and centuries of revolution lead to a stalemate and then begins again. So here you can see the rubbing that I made from the engraved concrete. So after the rubbing, I poured concrete on and I engraved again. So basically, I did rubbings on layers and layers of the engraving. This picture is from 2008. I drove a car where I engraved words on the wheel. Two phrases, actually. How can you become a failure? And the second phrase is, what do you lose when you become successful? So I drove with this car, and along the way, you see the wheel prints these words on the road. Actually, I drove past the Nanjing Bridge. And on the left, upper left corner of the right-hand side picture is an advertising for a very expensive villa. So basically, the advertising says there are only 30 villas left, and those who have foresight will be the winners. So actually, this made me think about why people commit suicide on the Nanjing Bridge. So if people make way for you, then where do you end up going? So actually, it made me think about the obsession with success in China. In the last 30 years, perhaps the key word in the Chinese ideology is revolution, but in today's China, the key word has become success. People have become obsessed with succeeding. so that people develop in order to achieve success. And this strive for success perhaps had driven many people to suicide. And here's a photo of the statue of Confucius. Of course, as you know, Confucius is the most famous Chinese loser. He was never successful when he was alive. And here we see a picture that reads, "Say goodbye to post-colonialism." Now, I was hoping to print the road with my wheels, but it was raining that day. So, in fact, I failed. So if we look at this picture, this is a destroyed sculpture of Lenin. Now, something like that will never happen in China because Chinese monuments are not people, are words. But of course, having said that, we've been noticing changes. A lot of new monuments in China are being done actually quite horrifically of pictures or the images of people. And can you tell where we are here in this picture? This is Terminal 3 of the Beijing airport. It's the entrance of the parking lot. In China, many regional governments have built their offices modeled after the Tiananmen Square. This is Huaxi Village in Jiangsu province. You can also see they have a statue that's made out of gold. And this is the provincial government of Chongqing. And here, this might look like the White House or some Western building, but it's actually the municipal office. This is the court of Shanghai, and here it is the government office of the Anhui province. This picture is taken of Detroit, the city in the United States. Most of us knows that Detroit was the automobile city of the United States, and it has been in great decline. But the last few years, we know that there's been a resurgence in Detroit. We saw that while nobody was going to Detroit anymore, a lot of buildings and on the railroad tracks, we saw many weeds and trees growing. So what has this taught us? Actually, the final victor is nature, actually. Everything may collapse, but nature will survive. I remember someone said that a building or a construction, in the process of being constructed, it is full of life. It's very robust. But after humans start to inhabitate this building, then the building actually loses its life. But after humans leave, the building actually comes alive again. So what comes alive is the natural vegetation. Nature takes over. On the left-hand side, we see it's a shipyard in Shanghai. And this is where the Contemporary Art Museum of Shanghai is actually located. And on the right-hand side of the slide is the Nanjing Bridge. If you look at historical pictures of the Nanjing Bridge, you only see concrete and steel. There isn't any vegetation. But today, at the Nanjing Bridge, you see many a lot of trees, you see a lot of life. So in other words, nature will wait patiently to take over. So this concept I tried to incorporate in my installation. From 2009, the exhibition, the structure of the exhibition is the coexistence of industry and nature. So here we see this is completely industrial, steel, concrete. We used the materials from railroads, from shipyards, rocks, stones. creating a city of failure. And on the right-hand side, or on this picture, you can see the robust and the thriving nature using bamboo, natural materials. And from the bamboo, life emerges. So we use bamboo to make a frame, but the bamboo can transform into a chair, into a box, becomes a ladder. So like the Chinese mythology of the monkey that changes 72 times, the natural products, in itself, can change. So this is what we call a slow miracle. Nature creates different shapes, different forms in a slow and protracted manner, like stalagmites and stalactites. They are formed over centuries in nature. Now, human beings will create models to reproduce what nature can do with ease. But humans use hard materials. So the concept that I'm trying to explore is the idea of eternity, the eternal nature of monuments. But actually, in China, we're not pursuing eternity. We're pursuing a constant evolution, continuously evolving, so that generation passing down to generations, that the life continues to evolve. So from the implementation of the Nanjing Bridge project, I worked together with many artisans who work with bamboo. Now these artisans they're disappearing. Fewer and fewer people know how to create art with bamboo. So they use bamboo to create different forms. And if you make a mistake, you can actually dismantle the bamboo and restart. And this is what I did with some of the artisans. We created different shapes and forms with the bamboo. For me, working with bamboo, working with these artisans, allowed me to think about different ideas or different approaches with my art, and how we separate creativity with labor. Artists have become creative people who actually aren't doing the work. So I wanted to experience working with the artisans, create something from scratch, and to actually work on the projects. This is a series of work that I did with bamboo that were exhibited in Beijing. So this is from my workshop working with rural construction. So I will stop here. Thank you very much.
Yes, any question?
Thank you. You've been working a lot in and about Nanjing. If I understand correctly, it is what in earlier sources in Europe was called Nanking. Did you integrate, it was in 1842, that the Treaty of Nanking was signed, which signaled the end of the First Opium War. And since you are working on monuments, failures, and historical memory, Is there any place or memory or monument in Nanjing? In Nanjing, about this opium war or the treaty that was signed between the then government and the British forces?
There is a specific monument collecting lots of trays of such historical events. And I myself have found a big grave. We call it 10,000 people's grave. It's very close to Nanjing Yangtze River Bridge. There was also a scholar called Tao, Mr. Tao, who made some words telling people to think back about the history, because that particular place was a hot spot for suicide people. We also have memorial kind of museum, because even when we do construction work, we from time to time discover the human bones. Whenever you dig the foundation, you find the human bones. Such monuments, well, it's all over the place in Nanjing, actually. Nanjing, the city, is quite a strange city. It is very beautiful, similar to the level of Hangzhou in terms of beauty. We can say Hangzhou is a female, is a feminine type of a city, whereas Nanjing has always been a masculine. They wanted to become a capital of China in Nanjing. So this is, you can call it fate, full of very sad history in Nanjing. After 10 years of a massacre, the Nanjing could suddenly become a very booming city. It's full of clever people. And then after 10 or 20 years, another massacre would happen in Nanjing. And we can call it a bit of a fate or destined to be like that. So we reflect the fact that those sad facts may not be purely related to communism. It is historically so.
I wanted to ask, I was very lucky to see your exhibition in, I think, 2008 in Beijing, in Ulin Center. And when I was there, I saw the City of Failure that you also explained today. And I'm really grateful, because I think now I get a grasp of what you wanted to do with that. But back in the time, and also today, I'm still wondering. Also, you said yesterday you were always using history. You think history is a very important part of art, or what art should help people understand, not to forget, to have the burden of history with them. And this is a very traditional piece that was in this whole steel-constructed ship yard thing. And drawing from that background, I wanted to ask if you could elaborate a little bit more on your disposition towards tradition, actually, and whether you think there is a difference between history, like leisure, and truantong, like tradition, where you see different concepts behind it, and how you would like to, or how you think you could differentiate that in your art.
Why do I need to think so long before answering? Was it Heidegger or Marx who said something about Chinese history? I don't know how should I put this. I think Heidegger was the one who said something about Chinese history. The Chinese treat history as a religion. In Chinese words, the word history is the same word for events or happenings. And the shape of the word is like a hand holding a pen. So actually, when you're working, you're creating events, you're also writing history. Now, I told someone, I said, in China, history is our religion. When an European decides he wants to do something good, he will usually tell you because he doesn't want to be punished by God, or he wants to do as the will of God. But in China, we will honor our ancestors instead of honoring God. We will often worship our ancestors. So in that respect, you can say that the Chinese culture is very superstitious. It's one mired in mythology. The Chinese believe we shouldn't kill, not because it's a sin from a religious point of view, but rather we are afraid that we will be leaving a very negative legacy, that we'll be considered an evil person in historical documents. For example, someone who is a historian at the court, at the royal court, he enjoys tremendous amount of power because even the emperor doesn't dare to kill him because he then instruct people to write negative things about the emperor. So you can see the power of history in the Chinese culture. We actually live for our history. It's almost perverted. In the Ming Dynasty, many government officials will say bad things about the emperor. They have a death wish. They want to be killed by the emperor because then they could leave a legacy in history. So actually, they get angry if the emperor doesn't want to kill them. So from a Chinese perspective, history, it is not... It's not only a document of events and happenings. It has been elevated to the fervor or the passion of a religion. So in the Ming Dynasty, we've seen how important that history became. In the Qing Dynasty, history also had a very important role, documenting everything that happened. But of course, historical documentation has its own limitations. Different villages have their, what you may call a village history. Different families have their own family histories. So if we approach history from a European, from a Western point of view, it is more of a narrative. So if we look at history in China, history is greatly respected. I think until today, history has always been respected. It is changing. The concepts are changing today. In the past, we always had a tremendous amount of nostalgia for the past. I think that in that way, we're a lot like the Greeks. We have a tremendous amount of nostalgia for the past. Like the Greeks, they also worship mythological characters. And in China, we tend to do the same. We idolize or mythologize some of the old emperors. So what is ancient? What is ancient is considered valuable, values that should be passed on. So in that way, you can say that our eyes are fixed to the past rather than to the future. If we look at Christianity and communism, Christianity and communism both had a tremendous amount of impact on the Chinese ideology, pushed the Chinese ideology to the future. And the direction of history also completely changed. As we approach the future, our eyes are fixed, almost tunnel vision to the future. That's what we see in China now. A lot of sculptures are facing forward, are one direction, almost like an arrow, running towards the future. For example, the high-speed rail, that's a perfect example of how now the trend, the view is to go forward, go fast towards the future. But if we are only, while we are going towards the future, but our eyes, what if our eyes are still fixed to the past? That creates a disconnect. Creates a new sensibility. I think in 2006 or 2007, I was working in Hamburg. It was a workshop on what is avant-garde. At the time, we decided to go on the street to join protest, but we decided we wanted to walk backwards instead of forward. And a lot of Germans actually were very angry at us. Like, why the hell are you walking backwards? And we said, hey, we're avant-garde. But some people said to us, in Deutschland, we only move forward. We don't move backwards. They were very angry at us. I guess I was trying to demonstrate the relationship that the Chinese have with history, that we're looking at the future, but one foot is stuck in the past. I do think that today's China is changing. I don't know, do we need to change? I don't know if I've answered your question, but I've shared some thoughts. So I think this is a perfect segue to what we like to talk about tonight, which is history, how we can start looking at the future, looking at today from history. So let me start my presentation.
We were walking backwards in Germany. These onlookers were very curious about our behavior. But we were doing that seriously. It was like a political movement, if you like. Then afterwards, we had another kind of parade in New York, but that was a total failure. The New Yorkers were said, what did you do? What were you doing, guys? Then we were not that serious, like we did in Germany. We couldn't help laughing at ourselves, and the effect was totally a disaster. We didn't achieve any purpose. Then We are going to show a documentary on the big screen. It's the theme for China's biennial show. We spent 2 weeks to prepare this documentary film. We're going to play it on the screen. I would like to say that the biennial show in Shanghai is one of the earliest and most important in the world. This year, we started a very new concept. We call it the first contemporary gallery or museum in China. Today, I would like to analyze with you on a particular project, which is staged in one of these in the biennial show. It's an intercity pavilion. This concept we've been pondering on it for a long time. After a few years, last year, 2012, the Chinese government gave us the go-ahead to stage. I think this is a process of negotiation. Starting from 2004, I was talking to the Shanghai government that you must stage this biennial exhibition. Negotiated for many years. I said they did invite me, so I said we must stick to the intercity pavilion. Why do you think it is important? Why you stick to this concept? You didn't want to do anything else. The reason are several folds. One is that I think a biennial show in Venice is tremendously good, because you won't be disappointed when you visit Venice. If there is a shortcoming regarding one city, you will be glad that you will not be disappointed by other cities like New York or London. So the model itself is very good. We call it a hot pot model, like a food. You have some soup, some stock, and others can add the ingredients of food. So this becomes a kind of a banquet of the world. You could dislike some of the ingredients, but there must be one of the ingredients that you will be to your taste, you know. So, but I think if government is involved, there will be a problem, because the government will obviously put forward some of the concept of politics and ideology. You have the conflict of a strong nation or a weak nation, and the government would say this artistic event is a kind of a representation of a country's power. But I would say you won't put a country or a state into play, but rather you want to emphasize the city. Why? Because if you, for example, of China and Japan, you talk about these islands or these islets, they would argue politically, saying this Diaoyudao or the Senkaku is Chinese or Japanese. But if you focus on a city, then things will be quite different. You will turn your attention to this everyday life, the cooking, the people's living.
So in other words, what you're saying is that when we talk about concepts of countries, we actually make the issue a very large issue, whereas cities are smaller, more approachable. So actually, when we talk about cities, we can separate the concept from nationalism or from imperialism. We can actually focus on the cities themselves rather than on the all the ideas behind. Sure, I think we're talking about multi-layers. We want to, you know, get rid of the baggage of nationalism when we talk about countries. With the Biennale in Shanghai, we invited more than 30 artists. Now, if at the, let's say if at the Venice Biennale, if you have 30 Italian artists, people won't be that interested. Actually, it's much more interesting having 30 artists from all different cities. So in the Shanghai Biennale became a platform that joined the artists from 30 or so different cities. And each artist or each city competed with the other. So, in fact, we didn't have to do that much work curating this exhibition because all of the artists were very competitive themselves. Now, in this process, it was actually the first time the two of us curated this exhibition. We also took into consideration how we can interpret this subject with relation to not only the cities themselves, but also the people who live in these cities. So, in fact, it's the joining of an old concept and a new concept. I think it is related to the spirit of the Venice Biennale. So through your experience, it seems that the most interesting links that were the ones that we're able to find a connection with Shanghai, for example, with Detroit, that you mentioned the connection with Shanghai. Perhaps you can also talk a little bit about the concept of Berlin in the exhibition. The Berlin pavilion actually was structured by Peter from the Goethe Institute. And I think he worked with a group of architects from Long Labor Berlin. Through their research, they decided to represent one of the key artists from the Bauhaus period, who was a leftist, actually, who left Berlin and went to Shanghai at the age of 26, worked in the Shanghai Planning Commission and worked on several projects. But later on, he returned to East Germany and became one of the most important architects of East Germany. So, if we look at the history of architects, that from age 26 to 46, the prime of his career, and he studied in Shanghai, or he worked in Shanghai for 20 years of his life, and then went back to East Germany. So actually, can we say that a lot of what he learned was actually during his time in China? So he took the knowledge that he acquired in Shanghai and took it with him back to East Germany. So if we look at the different elements of his designs, the different pictures, the different visual elements, we actually see a lot of elements from Shanghai. And of course, the urban or the city pavilions have been dismantled. But some people have asked if it's possible to keep some of these pavilions in China. So now we've gotten the okay from Tongji University, and they will be keeping some of the original exhibitions from the cities. I think there were more than 100 artists involved in this city project. And we've noticed also, actually it was quite intentional that the cities did not represent the capitals of the capital cities of the countries. Of course, earlier we said that we were very interested in seeing the connection with Shanghai. And we specifically wanted to profile the cities that were not very well known in China, or rather inaccessible to the people in Shanghai. Do you think that Shanghai was an appropriate location, appropriate venue for such an exhibition? Yeah, I do believe that Shanghai was a good location. Many foreigners who visit Shanghai feel immediately comfortable. Unlike in Beijing, there's a lot of pressure when you visit that city. When you go to Shanghai, you feel very much at ease. Shanghai is a port city. It's a city rich with international history. People from all over the world at one point or another lived in Shanghai. So I think Shanghai is a perfect city to host such an exhibition. Shanghai is really the perfect venue, because Shanghai, as we know, historically had a German areas, Jewish quarters, Japanese quarters. So Shanghai has always been very international. Of course, in selecting the cities that were exhibited, we took into consideration the dynamism of the cities and also the connection that these cities may have with Shanghai. So as a result, we saw that many of the cities that were profiled were not necessarily capitals of the countries. So a lot of these cities, they consider themselves the Shanghai of their own countries. For example, like Mumbai is the Shanghai of India. And of course, also, we wanted to profile the cities that exhibited historical diversity. We didn't pick New York, we chose Brooklyn, for example, because Brooklyn on its own is actually the fifth largest city in the United States. The Brooklyn accent is classic. In many movies, we hear the Brooklyn, the New York accent that's from Brooklyn. So for multicultural people, Brooklyn is actually their home, because Brooklyn is home to many, many different cultures, different ethnic groups.
We are very glad to be participating in this project, and we are very happy to spend time into it, and quite willingly. But of course, there are some particular issues which I'd like to talk to share with you. And you are a Chinese, and I from the West. You know, when we communicate with each other or interact with each other, there's some sort of problems. But on the other hand, we need to interact with each other, Eastern and West. But increasingly, we find lots of artistic projects, particularly those from the West, and they have some sort of a bias or some sort of arrogant attitude, if you like. How do you view this kind of a phenomena? in terms of contemporary society, from the contemporary Chinese person's point of view, how do you think we should deal with such issues? How to introduce or promote the Chinese ways of doing things in order to smoothen the kind of a prejudice in the Western people's mind? I think inner city pavilion itself is making an effort towards this direction. When we decided to do this inner city pavilion project, I was thinking to myself, I would compare it with the Olympic Games and Expo, Shanghai Expo. We know earliest in 1895, the Biennale was staged in Berlin. It was a historical product, if you like. Olympic Games, we know the participants are countries or states. They have a slogan saying that the value is participation. But there is a negative effect to it. If you're going too fast, you're going to kill yourself on the motorway. If it's too, the building is too high, it's prone to collapsing. I think I myself is quite against the Olympic movement. I don't quite agree with the slogan of Olympic Games when it comes to the recording the tally of medals. I don't think it is correct to say participation is the most important thing for Olympic Games. For me, it is another aspect, because you are participating, but if you lose and if you win, your feelings are totally different. And also, when people's attention is focused on the gold medal rather than the silver or bronze, then it is also a kind of a bias. And you don't idol the losers. You might respect the losers in the Olympic Games, but it's quite different. It's like, you know, the animal instinct. If you lose, you're a failure. Well, for Expo, again, you are communicating with it, interacting, but it is difficult. It's difficult for you to put your shoes on, put your feet into other people's shoes. It's a kind of a friendship on the surface. For Expo, every country wants to showcase their excellent performance or excellent results. For Germany, they stage the high tech, but for those weak countries like Nepal, they might say, we are poor people, but people living a happy life. So it's just, if you focus on the advantages of a country, then there's always something to promote. This kind of mentality is linked to the culture of a particular country, whereas Olympic is each country showing their strong points, whereas Expo is focused on the interesting aspects. Nepal is not very strong, but nevertheless, they can showcase the interesting things to the world. Other countries still show their history, which again links to the interest of a particular country. But for artistic biannual performance, we shouldn't be doing things like Olympics or World Expo. I don't think that these are our mission. Our mission for artistic annual, biannual showing is to display our
so we
negative side. So we particularly pick some of these countries, cities like Lima, Bogota. These are linked with disasters, natural disasters or human-made disasters. So this should be a stage for different countries or different cities to communicate with each other, focusing on their sadness. We discussed these things several times in the past. I think people can understand such a theme. In Japan, these exhibitors were quite moved because China and Japan are very close, and also historically people hate each other. I wrote to the Japanese counterparts. They had the same feeling, saying that we need some kind of insurance. You Chinese should promise that our people won't be hurt, won't get hurt in China. So we, in other words, we can't stop communicating with each other. For example, this earthquake hit prefecture in Japan, they, after the natural disaster, they might understand our mentality. But other countries may have a different idea. They come here to show their strong side, like joining the Olympic Games, which we don't promote. So you are thinking about your next event. Now, right now, you would try to have a better idea, focus on a different target or a different purpose, so that each city will be more realistically representing their city, either positive or negative, sadness and happiness. Yes, you're right. We think this is one of the most difficult problems. Several years ago, when the Shanghai Biennale was first staging the events, lots of foreign curators or enthusiasts, they went to China, to Shanghai, not for the purpose of making money, because they wanted to go to the communist country to make a story when they go back to home. That was in the past, but now it's different. When these participants go to Shanghai, they are totally different. They want to make money because they think China is rich. You have a lot of money, then why not we shouldn't make money? But in fact, this is not true. We think this is a huge change historically. Some of the artists underwent such changes. I think we need to tell them frankly, clearly, that China, although it's the second largest economy, but if you talk about per capita income, it's way behind many countries. Well, we also talk about that. Our understanding of a Chinese artist or artistic gallery is, or the investment of a gallery or a museum is different. Whereas for you, you want to create something and give it to the exhibition. I think you said about inviting Western or foreign artists. They have, tend to have this kind of prejudice. How do you go about to resolve the problem? How do you try to to shorten the gap between the two, between Western and Chinese, and how to make improvement so that those small problems can be eliminated. For China, whether it's ordinary people on the street or the Chinese artists or even the Chinese government, what they really want to do is to tear off themselves rather than beautify themselves. I think this is the one of the urgent things to do so that people can. It's a kind of self-criticism that we really needed. The danger, or, and rather than you know boasting about themselves, the second largest economy in the world, we need to tell the world those shortcomings and these terrible backward situation in China. We need to review these negative sides of the Chinese reality. And these audiences in the exhibition, these Chinese, they were curious about everything, and when they find something good, they just pinch it and put it in their pockets. They don't, you know, even the parents raise their, you know, put their children on their shoulders in order to take pictures. I think this is totally unacceptable. Lots of foreign artists, they would criticize this. Why you want to put a red line fencing it off? I would explain it to them. Wait and see. You will see these audience may, you know, behave badly. Once the audiences are present, the foreign artists will immediately understand why we need to fence it off. So we need to explain things to foreign artists. This year we are doing the biennial in the new pavilion, new venue. But what I'm talking about is the old museum.
The people working at the museum have never even visited the Biennale in Venice. So without that experience, how can you expect them to naturally know how to receive the public when they come to the Shanghai Biennale? So, you know, I travel a lot abroad, and I think it's very important to train the people who work at the museums, so that actually we can never stop learning. The educational process needs to continue. And as a teacher, I take my students along with me and to show them how things are done. So I think it's important that we have at least three or four experienced individuals like yourself and like myself to engage in these activities. So now, if we look at the future of the contemporary museums in Shanghai, now we talked about some of our goals earlier. I think it's important to expand the scale of the exhibitions and also to share the concepts, to share our difficulties. And should we continue under the model of the World Expo? Furthermore, I think it's important for us to minimize the control. The city exhibition was brand new. It's the only time that we didn't have to be inspected by the authorities. So, and none of the exhibitions or none of the cities were censored. I think that's very important. So, how can we effectively and successfully carry out our projects? I think that's something that we should discuss. Now, how do we manage? Of course, we exercise a lot of self-censorship to begin with. Of course, in the process of selecting the topic, we already censored ourselves. But, you know, truth be told, we were not censored. I think that's very important. If the funding comes from the Chinese government, we can say the Chinese is using this as some sort of a propaganda or promotion. And they, of course, will feel that they need to support you, because if they are financing this project, it would be against their interests. To censor. So actually, what's important is to be independent in the financing. I think the main themes, they need to be expanded. That would be important for the success of our future. So besides what is exhibited inside the Contemporary Art Museum, the next time, can we use, for example, the power station of art, which is located on Nanjing Donglu? Do you think that's a venue that we can use? Of course, there are a lot of beautiful colonial structures, architecture on Nanjing Donglu. But in other areas of Shanghai, they're also very interested to host these exhibitions. So we can, of course, talk to them. Shanghai offers endless potential and resources. There is so much space that is available for exhibition, so we can absolutely use them. And there's going to be more beautiful space. I don't think space is an issue. The issue is actually the work involved, because it really takes a lot of work to put this projects like this together. In the future, even if we are not going to be the ones orchestrating or curating these exhibitions, we will still need the assistance of other people. So now let's maybe take a little break and open for questions. Are there any questions from the audience? So if you ask your questions in English, I'll translate for Qiu.
So you can ask in English and I'm going to do the translation to Qiu or directly to you. Oh, that's fine. Yeah. Is it okay? Yeah. And if Qiu needs, I can just quickly translate.
Thank you. And I see that, Qiu Lao Shi, you have been doing a lot of works in historical elements, but I think it's staying on a surface of introduction or a surface of what it is like. And considering your curator works in Shanghai, and you just mentioned that you want to reduce the number of the Chinese artists, I would like to ask, which would make you happier if your works, your own projects, and your curation jobs to be seen by, more by the Western audience or by the Chinese audience?
Okay, so you finished with your question. Let me just get up and walk around a bit. So the relationship between artists, before, when people ask me this question, I approach it as an intellectual. Su Dongpo, the famous Chinese poet. He got a lot of poets to work together. So was he a curator or was he an official of the government? Of course, he did gather a lot of artists or poets together. So in a way, he was a curator at his time. The Chinese intellectuals, they, of course, are not barcodes in a supermarket. We can't classify them that way. So a better way to look at the Chinese artists in the Shanghai Biennale, I actually didn't write any words. I presented five different maps. So my position is actually a mapper, a cartographer, someone who writes maps. That's what I am. When I have the opportunity, I would like to integrate. The idea is to integrate the societal influence and the personal influence, the artistic influence, traditional influence, to integrate these various influences and to build a mutually complementary relationship. So as an artist, when I compare myself to other curators, I have a home court advantage because I understand how artists think. And because I've curated, I've also created, it gives me a broader perspective to look at how to carry out the project. So I spent about a year to not work on installations, but to focus on the curating of the Biennale and worked on a dozen maps. So actually, those maps are based on my creation from the last year. And it is a kind of transcendence or an elevation from the work that I created in the past. It's actually a support or complementary effect from the different works that I have done. So joining the different elements together.
As I understood, education was always very crucial for your work, right? So as doing the total art studio, also with the influence of Joseph Beuys, for example. And I think when we worked together at the Guangzhou Triennial, education was also very crucial as part of the triennial, as we did all the different workshops in different parts. Inviting different artists to have workshop on the Hanshan Mountain, for example. And so my question is, if you had a similar or also a possibility to include different workshops or these educational subjects into the Shanghai Biennial.
Oh, yes, of course. You talked about just boys. when I was young, I was called bad boy. Even up to now, my studio is called Tortoise Studio. In other words, I'm quite emphasized, quite attach importance to education. We can say education is one of the core concepts. In Shanghai, I had a project saying a project called People's Project. Three workshops occurring concurrently. Young people, young writers were invited. and also the German writers were also invited. And also Holland Court from New York Times were also invited. These famous writers were invited to teach the young media people in China. We also had a curator's workshop and also a workshop for science and technology. Why we use glass or sunglass sun houses? The reason is because workshops like this get people together to exchange ideas. For example, David and me are like putting on a stage, a performance. But in fact, when two important people are talking to each other, they tend to talk over the dinner table or breakfast table. An old man from Moscow, if you give him a bottle of vodka, he would start it to talk endlessly. He will be very excited to talk everything to you. He will become a most excellent thinker. So for such important people, we'd talk privately, not on the stage. But if you put two people on the stage, they are, you know, it's artificial. It's like a performance. And also it's not consistent because the audience put up questions and your thoughts become interrupted. So I think the most effective interaction should be privately. That's why I decided to put the glass house or a greenhouse so that it's isolated from outside world. So I put this project. It's similar to the city pavilion. I talked to the city government saying that if this project is successful, I very much hope you would keep it as a Shanghai feature. I think this hope is being realized. And also when it comes to sponsorship, we are careful that you must be committing to at least 3 years of funding. Otherwise, I'm not going to touch it. May I also interrupt for the biennial? I think this is quite educational in nature, because Mr. Chu also said these curating people are very committed, and they draw tremendous pleasure from the education element of it. Tonight, I think it's quite late. I thank everybody, thank the organizers to give us a chance. Thank you.